all know this is a partnership between Tana and PKCA. Coming to us, we are a group of international masters and FIDE master and FIDE trainer that we have, and we are providing professional chess coaching to aspiring young players all over the world. So, and these are our recent achievements from the students who are with us in USA, and we aim to make chess fun and entertaining to learn, and also to achieve professional results too. So, and like, yeah, you can always contact us in this through these numbers. So without taking much of your time, we can just start the session. First, what we will do is we will try to just revise what all we saw in the first session. Then we will go to some other additional topics today. Yeah. So just give me a moment. Hope everyone can see my screen. So as we saw in the first class, we were seeing mostly about this, like how to set up a chess board, right? And how the pieces move, and how we need to set the chess board in a right way. As we can see, I will explain this in the first 5 minutes or so, and then we can go over to the new topics today. Understand? So as you all can see, the chessboard is set up in such a way that always your right hand square, that the right hand corner of your side of the board should be a white square or light square. Understand? And okay, it naturally transposes to left hand corner as dark square too. So only when you set this up in such a way, then you are keeping the board in a legal way. Try to understand this, please. Yes. So coming to this is the way how we set up the pieces on the board. Coming to the pieces, this is the king. And this is the most important piece in the game. Understand? So I can just show you that on the big board. Yeah. So yeah. So we have one king and he has one king. We have seen this in the earlier class, but I just wanted to revise for the new attendees so that everything will be clear for everyone. So as we can see here, king is a very important piece. And like, if at all we lose that, if at all the king is checkmated, then it's all over, right? So you should be very careful that you protect your own king with your pieces and attack his king. Understand? But the king is too old, it cannot protect himself on its own. That we will see later. Coming to the next piece, we have a queen. We have one queen, right? So the queen is the most powerful piece on a chessboard. The queen is the most powerful piece. It can move, like it can move on files, it can move on ranks, it can move on diagonals, it can do anything. So queen is the most precious piece that we have. And also, okay, it can take care of it can take care of itself, but it is precious, we should not get it straight away into the game. There is a time when we should get it into the game. So next up, the third most important piece in the game will be the rook. Generally, when we are learning chess from our parents or from our elder ones, right? Generally they use the term elephants for rooks, but in chess it is called a rook. R-O-O-K, rook. Understand? So rooks are, it is like they are the third important piece after king and the queen. Rooks are the important, most important piece. Then we move on to bishops and knights, the minor pieces that we have. I'll try to show that to you. Two bishops for us, two bishops for our opponent, two knights for us, and two knights for our opponents as well. As you can see, two bishops for us, two bishops for our opponent, two knights for us, two knights for our opponent. Yes, we will try to see how they move again afterwards. So these are called the minor pieces, the bishops and knights. These four pieces combined are called minor pieces, whereas the king, queen, and the rooks, these are called the major pieces on the board. And with these, additionally, we have seven and eight pawns. I can just skip them. Okay, I just got a message. Just a moment. The bishops and knights are equal, actually. The bishops and knights are always okay. When we go to professional terms, when we go deep into chess learning, you will understand when the bishops are important and when the knights are important. Basically, the value of both the pieces are same. Their value is of 3 points, that we will get to know later, right? And in open positions, where the position, where the board is very open, then the bishops are important. In closed positions, the knights are important, the horses, the knights. Understand? They are important. As you can see, we have eight soldiers. In chess terms, they are called pawns, P-A-W-N, pawns. And they protect us. As the name suggests, the soldiers, they protect us here. Understand? And in the last class, we have also seen how the pieces move. I can just show it to you in just 1 to 2 minutes. The pawn moves only one step at a time and can capture diagonally one step. It can control, for example, this pawn here can control this square and this square, like one step diagonal to it. That is what it can capture or it can control. And it can move only in a straight line, but and only one square at a time. But in the starting position, when the pawns are in the starting position, that is second rank for us and seventh rank, right? And it will be second rank for our opponent, but it is the seventh rank, right? As you can see, we will get to the coordinates later. The pawns in their starting rank have an option to move two places at once. Like, for example, here, I can move like this. Generally, the pawn can move only one square at a time. But when it is on the starting rank, it can move two steps at a time, only when it is on the starting rank. And also, the pawn has another two very special moves. That is, one is promotion and one is ampersand, which we will see in this class. Before that, I want to show you how all the pieces move, then we can dive in. Coming to the bishop, we have two bishops. One is a light square bishop, one is a dark square bishop. Light square bishop always moves in light squares. Yes, it cannot move on a dark square. It can always move in a light square. So, and the dark square bishop is vice versa. The dark square bishop can move in a dark square. It cannot move in a light square. Understand? And the bishops can move only in diagonals, in slanting lines. They cannot move straight. They cannot move in files or ranks that are standing lines and sleeping lines. No, the bishops can only move in slanting lines, which are called diagonals in chess. So, for example, here the bishop can move like this. And note that you cannot jump with your pieces on your own, when some of your own pieces or pawns are stopping. Let us assume, am I audible? I'm getting some messages saying that
you are audible.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, as we can see, the bishop can also move in this diagonal here, but as our own pawn is stopping it, you cannot jump over it. Only the knight, only our knights have the exceptional quality of jumping over our own pieces, also his pieces too. That we will see in few minutes. The first thing here, our bishop cannot jump over our pawn, as we can see. Only it can go this way. When everything is open, the bishop can, let us say this one. Yes. Coming to the knight, we will see an example of a move of a knight for our opponent. As you can see, the knights can move in L shape. The knights move in L shape. Understand? As you can see here, forward two steps, then right or left. This is how a knight moves. For example, here I can play this move, knight. As you can see, the knight has jumped over this pawn en route. The knight was here and it has jumped over this pawn. So this is possible. Also for our knight here, again, as I told you, knight can move forward two steps and then left or right, and side two steps left or right. Unfortunately, the chessboard is just ending here, so only it can move on this square. So let us assume that our knight moved here. Understand? So coming back, we will try to see the other pieces, how they move, and we'll go to the next set of things today. As you can see here, this is a rook. The rook can move on files and ranks, the standing lines and the sleeping lines, something like this. Also, as I told you, on the starting rank, the pawn can either move two steps ahead or one step. It is just up to us. Understand? It is just up to us of where the pawn can move. So we'll try to see queen and the king as well, so we can dive into the next topic. As I told you before, the queen is the most important piece and it is the strongest piece in a chess game. The queen is a combination of two pieces, that is a rook and a bishop. Understand? The queen can move in standing line, a sleeping line, and also in a slanting line, that is in a file, in a rank, and also in a diagonal. So the queen can move in either of these squares. That is why the queen is the most powerful piece. Coming to the king is so old. What to do? He is so old. He cannot, like, he will only do one step at a time. But that is why it is very hard for him to protect himself. Someone should be there for him to protect him. So now, along with the king moves, I want to introduce a topic which we did not, okay, we may have considered for a brief while in the last class, but here we will try to see it in detail. Here, as you can see, the king has one special move in a game, always. The king will have a special move in a game, that is castling. It is, in normal terms, in non-chess terms, it is called building a fort. As I told you, king is the most important piece in the game, isn't it? So you have to be very careful to protect it. That is why the king will have a special move which can be executed only once in the game, that is called castling, building a fort. How is it done? It is done with the help of a rook, always. Please try to understand this. Only the rook with the combination of the king can make castling. As we can see here, the king and the rook are in their starting positions, isn't it? The king and the rook are in their starting positions. Generally, we can castle by moving our king two squares to our right and the rook two squares to its left. But in this case, in this particular case, we cannot do a castling. The point is because when you are trying to castle, the king or the rook should not be moved before castling. If you can remember, we have already moved this rook in this game, right? We have already moved the rook. If you, I can show you the recap of the game that we played. Yes, we have already moved the rook twice. So when your rook or when your king is moved once before castling, they are not eligible to castle. Understand? So here I cannot do a castling on this side. And this is one more principle that I wanted to tell you. There are two types of castle. One is called kingside castling and one is called queenside castling. It is also the kingside castle is also called short castling. The queenside castling is also called long castling. We will try to see this. Just as we can see here, the kingside castle now is ruined because we have moved the rook. We could not think and we just moved the rook in the opening. But now we want to keep our king safe. What to do? We'll try to do queenside castling, which is long castling. We will try to see why we are calling it short castle and long castle. So to do a long castling, we will develop all our queenside pieces and remember that the space between king and the rook should be empty. There should be no pieces. As you can see here, we have a knight, we have a bishop, and we have a queen in the way. So we cannot castle. We cannot capture our own pieces. We cannot jump over our own pieces with the king. Only the knight can do that. Okay. So our first task here is to clear these three pieces so that the king can move to safety. We will do that. I am just playing out some random moves to let all of you understand what is castling. Here, white has a chance of doing a long castling, which is called queenside castling. How is it possible? And why is it called long castling? Because in the long castling, when you want to do a long castle, okay, the king either in the short castle or in the long castle can move two steps, that's all. Yes, can move two steps. In the long castle, it can move two steps to its left. Whereas in the short castle, it can move two steps to its right. But unfortunately, as we have already seen, we cannot do a short castle here. So let us come back to long castle. In a long castle, what happens is the king comes two steps to its left and the rook comes three steps to its right. Try to understand this, please. The rook was here and the rook comes three steps to its left. Whereas we will try to do a short castle for our opponent. As you can see here, black can play a long castle or a short castle because either of his rooks did not move. His king did not move. So this is a very good rule that, excuse me. This is a very good rule that I want all of you to understand. When you are doing a castling, the first point is the way of the king and the rook should see each other. There should be no pieces on the back rank. Yes, on the way that you want to castle. The second thing, either the king or the rook should not have been moved. This is very important. If either the king or the rook has been moved, you cannot castle. As you can see, black can either play long castle or a short castle. As white had done long castle, we'll try to see how a short castle works. here, what is a short castle? A kingside castle. It is, I mean, we are castling on the king's way rather than on the queen's way. Understand? Here, the king moves two steps to its left. Okay, for him, it is two steps to its left. I mean, when you see it from the white side, it is two steps to its right, isn't it? So, two steps to its right, and the rook moves only two steps to its left, if you can see here. But in our castling, if you can, the castling is regarded as only one move. Someone asked me, I just wanted to tell you. The castling is regarded as one move. I'll tell you how it is moved on a chessboard. Here, as it is a computer program, when we keep our king on the correct place, it automatically gets the rook to the square. But manually, when we are playing a game, right? When we are playing a game, we should keep the rook. That I'll tell you after this rule, I'll be going on to that rule. Okay. So as you can see, the rook, the king has moved two squares, the rook has moved two. Here, when we castle, we will get back to it. When we castled, it was very long, isn't it? We played two steps with our king and three squares. We moved three squares with our rook. That is the reason why the kingside castle is called short castle and the queenside castle is called long castle. Try to understand this, please. Yes? The next point is, the specific time to castle is, I don't think there's a specific time to castle. When you develop your pieces and when you feel that, okay, now it is the king's time to develop in an opening, generally we will come back to this in the next classes anyway. As you asked, I can tell you when you develop your minor pieces, when you develop your minor pieces first, you will clear the way for the king to castle, isn't it? Once you develop the minor pieces, you can castle. But it really depends on how you play in the real game. And coming back here to the lecture, here the king has moved two steps and the rook has moved three steps. So this is called queenside castle. We all know this. And in the game, please remember, that you need to, I don't know if you all know this, in chess there is a rule called touch move rule. What is touch move rule? Whatever piece you touch, you should move that. You can't say, no, I don't want to move this piece, come back and play other move. No, it is not possible. According to the World Chess Federation, the rules are these things. Yes, the rule is that whatever piece you touch, you need to play that piece. Regardless of if you like it, if you saw the move or not, you need to play that. In this case, in castling case, you need to move the king first, keep it two squares to its left or two squares to its right, then move the rook to the castling zone. Understand? In the case of queenside castle, in the case of queenside castle, we need to move rook three squares to its right, and we need to in the case of queen kingside castle, we need to move rook to the two squares to its left. You get to know this later too. And here, okay, before going ahead, we would like to take a short break. Naidamma, is it a good time to give a break?
Yeah, it's good.
Sure. Okay, we will just have a 1 minute break, 1 to 2 minutes break before we start again. In the meanwhile, we would like to thank the sponsors of conducting this, and we will try to we will show you a small video of the sponsors of this summer session today. We'll come back. We'll be back. Yes.
Thank you. అమెరికా తెలుగు వారి ఆదర అభిమానాలు. పిల్లలకు సులభంగా అర్థమయ్యేలా పాఠ్య పుస్తకాలు, బోధన పద్ధతులు. పిల్లలు కష్టపడి కాకుండా ఇష్టపడి చదివేలా చేస్తున్న లాభాపేక్ష లేని ఏకైక సంస్థ పాఠశాల. వివరాల కోసం పాఠశాల .net సంప్రదించండి. పాఠశాలకు తగిన అమెరికా తెలుగు వారి ఆదర అభిమానాలు. పిల్లలకు సులభంగా అర్థమయ్యేలా పాఠ్య పుస్తకాలు, బోధన పద్ధతులు. పిల్లలు కష్టపడి కాకుండా ఇష్టపడి చదివేలా చేస్తున్న లాభాపేక్ష లేని ఏకైక సంస్థ పాఠశాల. వివరాల కోసం పాఠశాల .net సంప్రదించండి.
Okay. Yeah. Hello again, guys. Thank you for our sponsors again. We will dive back in. Yes. Okay. I have a request to open the sidebar. I hope you meant notation. Okay. So okay, coming back to Kazzling, I hope you all have learned what is Kazzle long and what is Kazzle short, right? So there are one or two more quick rules in Kazzling which we need to, what is the use of Kazzling? One student asked me. The use of Kazzle is that you protect your own king, the most important piece. You need to protect it with your pieces, especially the rook, and you know all the pieces around. As you can see, all your main pieces, the queen, the rook, the knight, and the pawns, they are supporting your king, right? Otherwise, if the king is captured, everything is over. That's all. If the king is checkmated, everything is over. So you need to be very careful with your king. Okay. So, and I want to share with you one or two more rules in the Kazzling so that we can go to the next topic today. This rule, we saw how we can Kazzle and how many types we can Kazzle. We can Kazzle short on the king side, or we can Kazzle long on the queen side. We need to know in what conditions or in what situations we cannot Kazzle. One point we have already discussed, that our neither our king nor the rook should not be moved for a Kazzling. When you want to Kazzle, that corresponding rook, either it is on the king side or the queen side, it should not be moved. Understand? Or the king should not be moved. There are other cases when you cannot Kazzle. We will see that now. Okay, so I'll play out some random moves where we can see when the king cannot Kazzle. I'll just try to play out some random moves. Please bear with me. Here, okay, so in this position, can white do a Kazzling on the queen side? In this position, can white do a Kazzling on the queen side? I am welcome to any comments. I can see your comments. So just half a minute, we can just see. So okay, so yes, okay, the answer is no, you cannot. Yes, the bishop is controlling this square where the king is going. The king can never be in a check when castling. This is very important. The castling squares, as you can see, these are the three most important squares when castling is happening, isn't it? When you are castling, these squares are the most important squares, as the king and the rook are coming to those squares. So those squares, in this case, for those who know notation, otherwise also it's fine, the c1 and d1 squares cannot be controlled by your opponent's pieces or pawns. Cannot be controlled. If they are controlled, you can never go. It is just that way, right? Let us say you own your house, yes, and someone who you don't know enters that house without your permission. What do? You will just kick him out. In chess, you are not even kicking him out. Like you, it, they, I mean, there is, you cannot just, I mean, the other guy cannot just come into our campus. The same way this happens in chess too. When especially with the king, when the king wants to castle, we should make sure that the castling path should not be controlled by our opponent's pieces. This is one more rule where the castling can be stopped by our opponent. There was one rule which the castling can be stopped by us by moving the rook or a king. But here, the castling can be stopped by our opponent by controlling the squares of the castling zone. Understand? We'll get back to this later, not a problem. It is just an introduction of how castling. The king should be moved first, and the rook, then the rook. You should touch the king first, place it in the castle square, and then the rook. I hope you understand this. The next point I would like to discuss is, as you can see here, what are all these things? Are these some alien language? Is it? This language is called notation. Chess has its own language. Understand? Just like English, just like Hindi, just like Telugu, chess has its own language, which is called notation. Understand? So we will try to see how this notation works today. Because we have chess literature outside. We have books, we have so many videos, we have so many databases on chess, like a wealth of knowledge is there. Yes, when you want to study them, when you want to study some books on chess, notation is necessary. Otherwise, as I told you, it is just an alien language. So all this e4, e5, bishop c4, knight c6, knight e2, knight, all this is just trash for us, to be honest. Here, the question and answers can be answered in the last 5 minutes. So please bear with me. Let us come to the notation. We'll try to learn a bit of notation today. Then I can answer some of your questions. And then again, one more thing is, I think this video may be shared with you. We will try to see, and I'll summarize all the topics so that in the WhatsApp groups, it will be posted, everything. So please bear with me and see what I am teaching. Yes. So coming back to the notation, I'll try to clear the board. As you can see, if everyone noticed, there are alphabets and numbers. There are alphabets and numbers along the board. What are these? In chess, as we have already discussed, 64 squares will be there, 32 dark squares, 32 light squares. You all know this. It is just basic, isn't it? So it is divided. The chessboard is divided as 8 into 8 matrix. That is, we have 8 files This also we have discussed in the first class, but for the sake of notation, I am telling you again. We will have 8 files from A to H. So this whole file is called A file, B, C file. Right? The standing lines are always called the files. F file, G file, and H file. And we have 8 ranks. First rank, second rank, third rank, fourth rank, fifth, sixth, sorry, just a typo, seventh, and the eighth. So 8 ranks. So 8 into 8 combines 64 squares on the chessboard. Note that every square has its name. All of these squares has their names. For example, I just click on a random square. This has a name. This square has a name. How is it written? It is written to the corresponding to file name and the rank name. The notation for this square is E file. Note that file name first, rank name next. It is not 5E, it is E5. So the alphabets and the numbers combine to be called as coordinates. The coordinates, it is just like our Google or Apple Maps, iOS Maps. We need to know the coordinates of this of a particular area where we want to go. The same thing in chess too. We need to know a particular square where our piece wants to go. Where our piece goes, where our pawn goes. It goes to a specific square, right? So in this square is called E5. It is very important because all the chess material that you see, all the chess materials, the chess books that you receive, the chess books that you study from here, they will be all concentrating on this. So please try to understand this. As I told you, the square name is mentioned by the file name and then the rank name, E5. Let us see this. Can I get some answers of what this square's name is? Anyone? G7, good, very good. Again, file name and then the rank name. Yes? File name and then the rank name. Let us see how the whole notation is written. We will try to keep some of the pieces or all the pieces on the board. Just give me a moment. As you can see here, let me play this move first. What is this move? Can anyone tell what did I play now? I just played the pawn 2 steps. It is called E4. Okay. I'll try to show you how this works. Yes. As everyone can see here, the kings in the notation, you need to write the piece name first. You can see it here. The piece name first in capital letter. Then the file name, then the rank name. Understand? In the notation should be written in a way that your piece name and the square where it is going, the file name of the square and then the rank name. Understand? Here, what is the piece name? The piece name corresponds to the starting letter of every piece. For the king, the notation is denoted as K. For queen, it is Q. For rook, it is R, capital R. For bishop, it is B. For knight, please note it is not K again, as K has already been taken by the king. The knight will have N. And the pawn will not have anything. When the pawn is moved, it is just named as the square's name. For example, here, we don't write the notation as PE4. We just write the notation as E4. And always please remember that you should write the notation of this of only the square where our pieces or our pawn moved already. Understand? As you can see, it has moved from e2 to e4. So you don't write e2 e4. No, you need only to write where the pawn moved. That is what it is important. Okay, it is not important from where did it move. It is important what is the destination of that pawn or that specific piece. So the notation for this move is e4. Let us see this. Here, what moved? It is a knight, right? So n, where did it move? f5 and sixth rank. So it is nf6. The notation is written as nf6. Understand? I'll try to show you how this works, how we write the notation. As we can see, please try to concentrate on this. We'll come back to the board later. Please try to concentrate only on this notation window. As this is how a score sheet looks like. When you go to tournament playing after some months, when we go to a tournament, we will be provided with these notation sheets. You need to write notation in the game. It is compulsory. World Chess Federation has made it compulsory that we need to write the notation. Here, as you can see, the move e4 is white's move and the move knight f6 is black's move. Remember, one white move and one black move corresponds one move. So it is not that you play e4, that is one move, and he plays knight f6, it is second move. It is not like that. One move of white and one move of black corresponds to one move. And always write white's move on the left side and black's move on the right side so that it corresponds to one move. Yes, I hope you understood this. Coming back, we will try to see some more examples on how the notation is written. What about this? I have moved my bishop from here, from its starting square to this square. I want some answers. Yes, answers are pouring in. Very good. It is bc4. It is written as you can see on the notation window, it is written as capital bc4. The bishop is going to, or it went to c4. Yeah, we'll try to see one more example, one more new example for you, which is capturing and a check. We'll try to see how we capture your opponent's piece. Note that you cannot capture your own pieces or pawns. How we capture an opponent's piece or a pawn, and also what is a check and how we check. Let us see this move. Black has played his pawn to d5. So it is written as d5. Yeah. Let us assume that we capture this pawn. What did we capture? We captured a pawn. Yeah. And with what we captured it? We captured it with our pawn. So it is always written as when the pawn captures something. When our pawn captures something, we need to write the file name of that pawn and we need to keep them cross. As you can see, e into d5, meaning the pawn which is on the e file, cross meaning is that you are capturing something. I mean, it is not sure what you are capturing, that we can see in the game, right? But when you are writing, it indicates that the pawn on the e file is capturing something on the d5 square. Understand? So it is not that you need not write p into p, that means pawn into pawn. No, it is not the correct language. We need to write the pawn on e into d5, which literally means that the pawn on the e-file is capturing d5. Black captured this. And this is written as n into d5. Note that The pawn moves are always the square's names, but when you are capturing it with a piece, you need to write with the piece name. So which what captured d5 here? The knight captured d5. So it is written as capital N cross. That means it is capturing something. And what is it capturing on which square? I mean, it doesn't matter what it is capturing, but it matters where it is going, and which square it is going and capturing. As in this case, it is n into d5. It is knight into d5. Understand? This is how you write the notation of how to capture. The next thing I want to show you is how to keep a check. But what is a check? What is a check? A check is when you give a check when you attack your opponent's king, or when your opponent attacks your own king, we say it as check. Only when you attack your opponent's king, we say check. We can't attack one of his other pieces, let us say queen, bishop or a knight, and say check. No, it is not possible. Yes. So only when you are attacking or you are controlling your opponent's king's square, you say a check. In the tournament game, I think it does not matter if you tell a check or not, because it will be a disturbance to everyone. But in general terms, it is a check. Let us see how we can play a check. I played this move here. What is it? It is bishop to b and 5, right? And as you can see, we are attacking the king directly. It is not a checkmate. It is only a check. Checkmate is when we will of course discuss that. Checkmate is when the king has no square to move and it cannot be guarded by any of our pieces. But a check is where the opponent, your opponent or you, have a chance to revive the king, like to support the king, either blockade the king with some piece in between, or to capture that piece which is checking, or to move the king away. Black has that opportunity here. But first we will try to see how we write the notation. It is bb5 plus. The plus means check. Always please remember this. In the notation, you need to write bb5 plus. When plus is denoted, someone who sees the game can understand that, okay, a check has been given now. It is like that, right? So as you can see, this is not a checkmate. I'll give you an example of a checkmate list. As you can see, some piece or some pawn can come in between the attacking piece and the king. So it is not a checkmate. There are other examples too. Bishop d7 or knight d7 can happen. So let us go back. Let us see an example of a checkmate here. I'll try to play out some random moves so that you guys can understand. Okay, here black plays this, and this is a checkmate. Black plays this move, queen into f2, which is a checkmate. First of all, let us just understand why it is a checkmate and what is a checkmate. Checkmate is when the game is over. If you give checkmate to your opponent, he is lost. You won the game. And if he gives us checkmate, oh, sad, what to do? You lost the game. Yeah, it is always true. So in this position, white's king is checkmated. That is, no one can help him. We failed to defend our old guy, Bechara. He is like gone, isn't it? So as you can see here, the ways to get out of check, as we already discussed, is either we can move our king, or we can place something, some piece or some pawn in between the attacked piece and the king, or we can capture that piece which is checking. Here, these three possibilities are not possible, because first thing, you cannot capture this queen. The king cannot come into a check. Guys, please understand. The bishop is already controlling this square. So the king can never come into a check. Understand? So the first rule is turn down. You cannot capture the queen. Can you place something between the king and the queen? No. There is no gap. Let us assume the queen is here at least. Then we can try to keep some piece in between. But here that also is not a possibility. Here the king cannot move, cannot place something in between, and the king cannot capture, or either of your piece cannot capture that queen. So it is all over. Sadly, we are checkmated. We lost the game. So that is why you should be very careful while your opponent is playing. You need to see why he played it always. Understand? As you can see, this is a checkmate and it is written with a hash symbol. After the move has been made, queen into f2, it has been written by a hash symbol. That is a checkmate. It denotes a checkmate. Also, you can, even if you write two plus symbols, one plus is always a check. If you write two plus symbols, that also denotes a checkmate. Okay? So this is how you write how you play a check, how you play a checkmate, and all these things. Okay, so I think we can just take one or two questions before we end the session. I can quickly summarize what have been taught in these two sessions. In first session, the last Sunday, we were seeing the most important basics, that is how to set up a board, how our pieces move, what are the pieces, what are their names, and all this stuff. In this class, again, we revised everything what we did in the first class, and we were also seeing how to castle, when you cannot castle, and it is all about the king today. How we can castle, when we cannot castle, how we play a check, and how we write a check, and how we write notation, and also we saw when a checkmate happens. Yes, and how the checkmate is written. This will also be taught in the next classes as summaries. And apart from just give me a moment. Yeah, apart from this, we are also planning some group sessions and planning some individual classes shortly. So anyone interested can definitely contact us in these numbers below. Also, everything will be taught there, of course, all these things. And this is just a platform for us to represent ourselves, to show you what we can do, what how chess is taught actually in online. Okay, so Naidama, can we take one or two questions before we go, or let us wrap up?
Yeah, I mean, do you have any questions displaying by the students, or can I read out a few questions? Because I'm
Yeah,
getting a couple of.
can you please read out some questions, please? It is
Yeah,
not
so he's
visible.
asking to do a quick recap on castling.
Okay. So okay, we'll do a quick recap on Castle and we will break today. Just give me a moment, please. So yeah, as we can see, yeah, Castle. One moment, please. So castling is done. Castling is for the king, right? To protect our own king, we do a castle always. Understand? This is the first point. Second point, castling can be done with the help of only a rook, not by other piece. The king and the rook can be involved in the castling. And how do we castle? Castle only, generally, as I told you, the king can move only one square at a time, isn't it? But in one such special case, you can castle by moving two steps with your king. And there are two ways to castle. That is king side castle and queen side castle. As you can see, the queen is here. So this is queen side castle. which is also called the long castle, and there is kingside castle, which is called short castle. I mean, okay, it's not the terms are not that different, but how we do castle is very important. As you can see, there should be no peace, king and the rook, when castling will happen. This is the first point. Second point is how castling is done. Castling is done by moving king to two squares to its right in short castle, two squares to its right, and the rook two squares to its left. Note that as this is a chess program, the rook automatically comes to the f1 square, right? But in general board, when we are playing the game, generally your king should be moved first, touched first, and kept on two squares right side, and then the rook should be moved to f1, as you can see here. Understand? So this is how a castling is done. As I told you, the importance of castle is that you need to protect your king, otherwise we will be in danger. And the other topics will be covered in the next session. You can also, some material would be given also in the group, so please go through them. Chess is fun, please try to learn it. Yes. So we are also available. As we told you, we have shown our contact numbers. You can contact us anytime. Thank you everyone for giving us this opportunity.
Krishna.
And thank you, Tana, once again. We'll meet you next Sunday.
Krishna, can you share the contact slide again, because I am receiving several messages to display the contact slide one more time.
Sure, that's good. I'll do that. Yes, I hope this can be seen clearly, the contact page. Everyone can take a picture of it, something, then you can.
Thank you everyone who joined today's session, and we will see you again next Saturday, 7:30 p.m. Eastern time zone, for the third class, with additional details regarding how to join and other details. And please feel free to reach out to any of these contacts that is currently in display for additional details. And if you want any one-on-one sessions or any group classes, these international masters are really busy, so we'll try to accommodate their schedule as quickly as possible. Thank you so much.
Thank you all. See you next Saturday. Bye.